are entitled to all the rights they are deserved under the law. There are institutions that are crippling to actually leave. It is for that reason we are so proud to propose this motion before us today, that this House would require isolated religious communities to give monetary compensation to members that defect. Now, before I get into the constructive case for the proposition today, I just want to outline this model and who we're going to be representing in this debate, and define a couple of the terms that we'll be seeing running through this debate. So when we talk about who we'll be representing as the side government here, we're talking about the Canadian federal government. When we talk about isolated religious communities, we're talking about religious communities that are composed of only members of their sect that are isolated geographically from the rest of the country in terms of civilized society. When we talk about monetary compensation, we're going to be talking specifically about how we're going to be requiring under law that these religious institutions and these religious isolated communities are essentially going to be required to pay a four-month period amenities for the individuals that defect from these institutions in order for them to be able to reintegrate into society once they've made that decision freely. Okay, so what are we going to be talking to you about here inside a proposition? So essentially, we're going to be talking to you about the defectors themselves in two main ways. Firstly, how this actually aids in the reintegration of these defectors. And secondly, I'm going to talk about how this actually incentivizes this kind of reintegration that we want to see amongst individuals in isolated religious communities. So how does this firstly aid in the reintegration of defectors? So when an individual returns to society, they have essentially no connection to the social norms or customs that we are accustomed to here in Canada when we grow up under our normal, essentially the normal educational system that we have, okay? They are disenfranchised from the get-go. We think that actually providing monetary compensation for the amount that we've suggested is actually going to allow people to have the opportunity to reintegrate. But they're going to have the opportunity to actually be able to set up shop or be able to have a place to go in order for them to start their lives up. Not at this moment. We think that currently under the status quo, they lack basic elements that make up citizens in normal society. They lack formal education or medical treatment in certain cases like vaccines. We think in this way, they're actually being disenfranchised if they don't get this medical treatment. But what's more important is why we're asking the individual religious institutions to do this specifically. Why do we ask them to do it? Well, we think that actually the reason that all of these elements are missing from these individuals is because of this religious institution or because of these communities. We think it's their responsibility if someone chooses to reintegrate into society to pay that actual difference. We think they're the ones responsible for the discrepancy in the actual elements of the citizen. We think they're the ones that should be responsible for it. Would you not agree?
When I consent to joining a religious group and I know I probably am not going to have the same cultural norms that I would in normal society, isn't the burden falling on me when I then choose to decide that that's not what I want?
That would be an excellent point if everyone in a religious isolated community was someone who had freely chosen to go there. What about people who are born in religious communities, which are primarily composed of essentially people who were in that since they were in that organization since birth? We don't think there actually was a tangible choice there that we can describe. We think in that case, we need to make measures for them to be able to freely come out of that situation. We think that money actually allows for reintegration in order for them to get their feet on the ground, essentially. If not, what are the alternatives for these individuals? Well, firstly, we see that they either have to go back to their group, or they have to essentially be impoverished and live in society as essentially a ne'er-do-well or impoverished citizen. Firstly, why is that first point bad? We don't think actually going back to these religious groups is going to be good for that individual. We think actually that's going to be a source of contention. We think that person who has left the religious group going back is going to be actually, if anything, disenfranchised as well. We see this as an example. In 2007, two Amish boys actually had left their religious group, had re-entered it, and were beaten severely because of their misdemeanor. We think in this case, we're going to try to avoid that by allowing people to have the opportunity to actually reintegrate, instead of just leaving the institution or the isolated sect on this moment, but actually be able to come back to society. We think that's very important. And secondly, I don't think I have to really cover why being impoverished or discriminated against is really a bad thing. We think that's something that is an alternative, but it's not very good. So let's look at this second idea, why this actually incentivizes reintegration and why we think this is actually a good thing. Okay, so we think in regards to the individual, many times when these people are born into these religious sects that are isolated, it's very hard, near impossible to actually leave these sects. We think that actually, because of two things, social pressure and economic inviolability, they don't actually have the tangible capacity to make the decision to leave. They're not leaving based on belief, they're choosing not to leave based on economic problems. We think that it's the responsibility of the religious sect in order to make sure that that decision is being predicated on the idea of belief and not on economic inviolability. And it's because under the status quo, this individual is severely disenfranchised, and because we think it's the responsibility of the religious institution institution to pay for the discrepancy that exists between them and normal citizens. We are so proud to propose.